He's the king of
we'll be right back. Hello, everybody. Boy, I really messed that other song up. Can I ever play that right? It's like a shuffle. Crazy song. That was from the Peace Apice APPICE album with Carmine and myself. We can't decide on the pronunciation. Anyway, thanks for joining me again. I'm back with Lala from Trenton, New Jersey. We did this festival event, not festival, but big event there, and it was a lot of fun. We had a good time. We hung out with Gina from the Go-Go's. We didn't have any drums there, so we couldn't do anything. But she was there, and very popular, I must say. She got the book of photography, and she does a lot of stuff. Yeah, she said she wanted to use this lick in one of the We Got the Beat. Wouldn't let her. All right, so we got back, and of course the plane didn't take off on time, so that was a nail-biting thing. We had to fly back from Philadelphia to Phoenix, and then Phoenix to San Diego. And they were waiting for a crew. So it's like, oh, man. So here comes one crew. Okay, after like 10 minutes. I only had we had 45 minutes in Phoenix to catch the next plane. And that's one crew. And they're waiting for more crew. Then another girl comes up. And then another girl. One of them had a pizza. It's like, wait a minute, we're all waiting for you. Did you stop for a pizza? Keep the whole plane waiting? And then finally, the fourth girl. It's a hot mic. It's distorting a little bit. Sorry about that. And that's that one there. Let's put that down. See, I got the mixing board right here to mix this stuff. And there's my brother Carmine. He's actually got the mustache too. See? There he is. The Nutcracker. Can you see him? And we went all out on the tree. If it was up to me, that's just the only tree I'd put up. Put some balls on it. And speaking of balls, where is that? I bought this at the event. I love this stuff, right? This is the one of the coolest things I bought. This is the Monster Ornaments. Check this out. Look. It looks like me, Phil Soussan, Andy Freeman. Viv's not there. He's got those dolls. But anyway, this is called the Monster Ornaments. Isn't that cool? I love it. And it didn't break bringing it back from the airlines. And that is because I carried it myself. At one point, it bumped, but I forgot about it. And the weather was good, got some rain, but the day we left, it was nice, and it was a great event. And then this weekend, we're going to a Terror Fest. Terror Fest. I'm actually going to play a little bit. Black Sabbath songs. I'm going to jam a couple of Sabbath songs with one of the bands. I guess they were Black Sabbath tribute band. It's easy for me. And there's going to be a battle of the bands. It's going to be a really good event. A lot of people, a lot of vendors. That's called the Terror Fest in Conroe, C-O-N-R-O-E, Texas. When I first did it, advertiser, I said, it's Conroy. And then they said, no, it's Conroe. It must be a Conroy, too. And that's going to take place on Saturday and Sunday. So that's going to be a cool one. Then I'm finally off, right? So next Tuesday, I probably won't be here. And the Tuesday following. After New Year's, I'll come back and do this again. And thank you for joining me and keeping me on your Tuesday schedule. So that'd be cool. So what else is going on? I've been getting a lot of emails and stuff. You know, I do a couple online lessons, which I enjoy doing. And it was about getting into tuning the drums. I want to show you something, right? Okay, got to have a key, right? So when you get the drums, you get a new set of drums if you're a beginner and you don't know what to do with them, you want to tune them somewhat. You don't want them to sound like, let's see, I'm going to go down on this one. Because usually things loosen up when they're shipped or you put the heads on. That's because these are sawtooth hickory drums. I hear this. Oh. Oh my God. How are you going to play that? Now I'll go even lower. What, that's like hitting a pillow, like. Instead of. See, that drum sings. It's got the right pitch. By pitch, it's the pitch to that size drum. This, you got to take care of this stuff. So what you want to do is start tuning this guy up. Most drums are going to be tuned loosely as this one is. So when I tune it up, and I got to tune it all the way back up, right? So I'm going to tune it up, and the difference is the tone. See? Now I got some tone. Then I like to go lug to lug. And tune, like here and this. One lug, second lug. This is a little higher, so I tune it down. We'll tune this one up. Try to get them close. Right. See what a difference? And then if you do a fill. The other thing that happens when you tune the drums up is you get more response off of the head because it's tighter. So it's easier to play faster. It's easier to play. Now that goes for the snare drum too. I've heard a couple of these
kind of snare drums. Check it out. In the studio, you might want to, if you were recording, you might want to mess with your tuning and tune the snare drum down a little bit. But for live playing or practicing, I hear this. Drastically out of tune. Really too loose. Oh my God. Somebody help. See, this doesn't sound good. It sounds like an old beat up snare drum. See the beat? That might sound good in the studio, but it's hard to play because there's no response. See? Sounds like two different sets. Dead, response. So you want to get the key and tune the snare drum up a bit and then experiment to where you find a spot that you like the tuning. I know what my snare drum, from that, I know what I want to sound like. That's still low, right? A bit low. Snares are a bit loose, I tighten them. Now tuning them tighter. That's about it. See? Lug to lug. See? See, that sounds better. Now, the other thing is, especially if you got a lot of toms, what you don't want to do, you got to have a spread. Yeah, these drums are tuned with a spread, so they go from high to low. See? Ba 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 boom. You know, that's what I want to hear. I don't want to hear it not actually building up to the bass drum. You know, this builds up. Boom. Right? You don't want to tune like this. Watch. It's. Here we go. I hear this too. You go. Doesn't that sound like the same drum? Same tuning. Actually, that's even a little.
Hey, could get it closer than that. Yes.
You know? Now I go. Yeah. It doesn't sound good. You got to have a spread. So this guy's got to come up above that note. Of the drum that's bigger than it. So as I tighten this, there we go. Let's see where we are now. A little higher. But I don't want to go too high and get to that note. That's close. So I tune it down slightly. Still a little high. This way the drums are musical. Something loose still. Yeah.
guys. Distorting. Let's bring it down.
I tend to hit them hard. So that's a little insight into tuning. This is still too high. See, nice spread. And then the bass drum is big. And then you have a spread between the bass drum and the snare drum. If you don't have all these toms, you might have one rack. You still want to have that. Bap, boom, boom, boom. That's the exclamation point on the kit. And then you need the spread between the snare drum and the bass drum. See? It's a nice spread. And years ago when Bonham came out with his sound, everybody was trying to get the Bonham sound. And they were having these big, fat snare drums and triggering them with a lot of bottom end, thinking the snare drum sounds so big. But if you really listen to it, it's kind of tuned about here. It's got some brightness to it, and the thing that made it work was the bass drum was big. So the bass drum complemented the snare and vice versa. And that snare drum tuned, you know, middle high cuts through everything too. So little insight on tuning. And these, of course, are the Hickory drums by Sawtooth. This is the higher end drums, 10, 12, 13, 14, 16, 18. That's the guy. And these are six ply pure Hickory. They sound great, these drums. So if you have good drums, that'll help too, you know. And the skins also help. These are Evans G2s all around the drums. Evan heavyweight on the snare. And the bass drum's EQ3 with the ripped out muffler, because I don't like the muffler built in. It's too dead. See, this is not dead. It's got a nice live sound to it, you know, and it's easy to play that way. So that's the way you tune. It's a little insight on it, and then what you got to do is just find a place where you like it. Start with the kick and snare and mess around with the tuning. Don't just play the drums out of the box or not have a key, you know. It's Christmas time. What you want to get is a key. Have a key. That's the tool of the drums, you know, is the key. Then a lot of times, like me, you drop it, and while you're playing, you're gone. Where's the key? Can't find the key. I even tried years ago. Somebody came out with a key with a like telephone cord on it, so you can stretch it. That didn't work. It worked. It didn't work for me. It probably worked for somebody else. And also, we got a lot of comments on that picture that I posted, which was the Dio band and Angelo Arcuri, the engineer, and Chemo, our security guy, up at Colorado. And that's when we did the Last in Line album. And we had about five and a half, when we went up there. I remember we wrote We Rock up there for sure. You know, we said, well, let's something start with the drums, you know. Okay. How about bass and drum? Boom. A couple accents. You know. And, but the thing up there, we went up there in April, and it's almost 9,000 feet. And it was snow on the ground. Every time we walked around in the snow, because we had individual cabins to stay in. I shared a cabin with Claude Schnell, the keyboard player. Ronnie had a cabin. Jimmy slept in upstairs in the lodge. which had a pool table downstairs. That was like the party central. And, of course, Jimmy slept there. I don't remember where Viv was, but it took a couple of days to get acclimated to the height, you know. And I remember the first day we set up, and then I'm out of breath. And so we didn't really record anything the first day, but the second day we were getting into it and everything was cool. And then Ronnie didn't really have to sing until maybe 3 days in, and he was used to it already. Such a strong singer that, you know, he belted it out. And then by the third day, we were like kicking. And then we wrote the rest of the album there, and it was fun. We were very isolated, and we went into town, and Jimmy met some friends, and there was a couple of good parties there too. A lot of grain alcohol, which was deadly. And that's how we made that album. The other thing, I played up in La Paz, Bolivia. We did a show, and it was me, Zach Wilde, and Blasco on bass. And it's the weirdest show. I mean, I got off the plane at 14,000 feet, and my head felt like I was in a vise. Couldn't breathe, you know. It's terrible. And so they said, there'll be oxygen tanks there. So when we got to the hotel and the venue and everything, there were oxygen tanks there, but they were all empty. So it was like a constant headache, you know. And we went on at about 1:30 in the morning. It was outdoors, and we played six Sabbath songs, the old stuff, and with Zach and Bosco, you know. And it went on so late, and we had to be downstairs like at 5:30 a.m. to catch a plane. I'm playing. I look at the clock. I go, holy shit, we're going to miss the plane, you know, because Zach likes to play solos, if you notice. And we kept going on. And finally, when you're the drummer, you got control. You can go, all right, we need to end it. And you just ended the song. So that's what you got to do. So anyway, we have Lala Lollipop here.
Hello.
She wasn't feeling that great this morning, right?
No, I think I ate something bad.
Oh, okay.
I had a stomach ache.
Yeah, you shouldn't eat that bison dog.
Right, like I would eat that.
I look like a ghost.
The lighting's
terrible. Can you turn that somewhere else?
Yes.
The whole thing. Yeah, that's better. All right, we don't have colored light, but that's okay. So, but she's feeling a little better now.
Yeah.
You have fun at the event?
Oh, yeah, it was great. It's a lot of great vendors and a lot of nice products. Everybody works really hard.
Yeah, I like going shopping there.
Yeah, we like that.
Like these balls, Christmas balls are awesome. So anyway, let's take some questions and see where we're at.
Okay. Have you ever tried a head, sticks, and gloves? Called a head.
No. Are those the aluminum ones? If so, I did try the aluminum sticks. I didn't like them. Because the aluminum, you know, when you're playing with wood sticks and you hit and the stick's going to break, it relieves the pressure. With the aluminum, what's supposed to break vibrates into your wrist. I don't think that's a good thing. I'm going to have to get gloves because on the last tour we did, mini tour with Last in Line, we did like six shows, and my hands are so callous, I couldn't even close my fingers, you know. So I'm going to try some gloves, see what happens. I never wore them ever, but I don't know what it is. Playing harder, I don't know what it is. It's not I'm getting older. Come on. Who said that?
No.
That guy in the front there. You know. Okay, next question.
Do the drums come with mounted toms, or do you ever do that? Or?
Well, these drums you could order from Sawtooth. You can order anything you want. So you could order this tom with a fitting on it to go on a stand, as this is. You could see there's two toms on one stand. Or you can, I think you could order it just with the tom and put it on the snare stand if you're only using one tom. You know, so you can customize your order, and you could order. They have kits up there like four toms, and you could also order it, say, with three toms, which is one floor. You really can customize it out, which is good. It doesn't come in a complete set. But great, great drums, and all the hardware on the drum is solid steel, made in Superman's planet, kryptonite, solid steel hoops, and die-cast hoops, solid steel lugs, which are really strong, and they hold the tuning, which is great. And even these stands are chroma cast. I don't know if you can see it, but the fitting on the toms and on the legs of these floor toms, the wing nuts are huge. You got a lot of torque in them, so they hold up great. Okay, next question.
How do you stop the snare from vibrating when you hit the toms?
I don't. That's the thing about a drum set. Let me tell you something real quick. If you take the snare drum in another room by itself, it's going to sound like a snare drum in another room by itself. Same thing with the toms. This tom, bass drum, you put in another room. But when you put drums together, everything goes into each other. It becomes one monster. See? The difference. Now, the bass drum vibrating the snare, it's okay. That might be vibrating the snare. The snare's vibrating the toms. But when you put the whole kit, everything's kind of sounding together. You know, all the sounds going into all the drums. And you get a nice sound, a big sound. That's what the drums are about, you know. You can't really isolate everything unless you completely deaden up everything. But I'm not into that, you know. You'd have to put some tape on here. You have to put pillows and blankets in the bass drum. And, you know, if you want to get a big rock sound, this is the way to go. It's all open, and you tune them. Make sure they complement each other, like I explained before, with the spread. So it's like an orchestra, you know, one drum by itself in a room or whatever. It sounds like it, one drum by itself. When you put all these guys together, it's like the orchestra. Here's the brass section, trumpets, trombone, tuba, and the bass cello. This could be lead trumpet. I like that. Okay, let's take another question.
Did you ever meet Butch Patrick from the Munsters?
Butch Patrick from the Munsters, because in this upcoming event, Butch is going to be there, among other horror stars. Yes, I met him at a fest, some horror fest, years ago. He was cool dude. And I met Leave It to Beaver, who were like, you know, my idols. Leave It to Beaver. Da 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 da. I want to play the theme. Anyway, so he's going to be at this event too. So it's going to be fun, and I'm going to get up and jam with the band, doing the battle of the bands, and it's going to be a good show. Might as well play, right? Bring sticks. I'm going to hop on somebody's drums. Now it's like, oh God, knows what these drums are like. You know, we'll see. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're bad. All right, next question.
Will Hanging and Banging ever return?
Hanging and Banging, that's the show I did with Carmine, and that's something that the pandemic had a baby and spat out. That's like a lot of things happened during the pandemic, you know, like that show, because nobody could play live, and we didn't play live. And as with other people, they started doing recordings. They did podcasts, streams like this. We started doing this, and this keeps going, thanks to you guys. And I don't know. Maybe it will. Maybe it will. We'll have to see. But and also the Dio movie is on Showtime now. Check it out. It's pretty good. It's a great insight into Ronnie's career, you know. All right, next question.
What happened to the lighted sticks you used to use when with Dio?
The what?
The lighted sticks.
The lighted sticks. Wow, you remember that? The lighted sticks, that was probably 1984 on the Last in Line album tour. And what that was we had lasers all over on stage. But back then in 1984, to have lasers, you could go to the Guitar Center and buy a box that has shoot some lasers and stuff. But back then, the equipment to generate the lasers was huge. It was took up the whole back area of the arena. It's like these big boxes that would shoot a laser into a mirror, then this mirror would shoot into that mirror, make it focused and get it stronger, and it would be all over the place. So what the sticks were they were clear sticks with a wire, a laser. I guess it was fiber optic back then. And it shot the laser in the sticks, you know? And so I would be playing, yay! And then bring the sticks up, and they would be lighting up colors, and people would go, ah! You know, pretty funny. So that's what those were, and I could probably find another variation of those with a battery. I think Vic Firth actually had some that lit up with batteries in them. The problem with that is you can't really hit all these things very hard. You know, you can break it. You know, you have to go. Pretend you're hitting it hard. But, you know, otherwise, they break. So, I don't think they're going to come back. You know? Plus, I play with the butt end. Okay, next take. One more question. Those abrupt stops. Boom. Okay.
Do you like it when bass players follow your fills a lot or only once in a while?
I like it when they follow the fills. It's hard to do live because I tend to play a lot of fills and they're spontaneous. But yeah, I like it. But if they do too much and I do too many fills, it's overkill. But I played with one player. I think it was the bass player. And this was years ago. And we're playing, rehearsing. And he's standing in front of me just watching. He's playing. And I'm like, this is making me feel uncomfortable. He would just stare at me. Finally, I said, dude, the audience is that way. Don't stare at me the whole time. You know, you're making me nervous. It's the weirdest thing, you know. So. When we played the gig, he's doing both, you know. But on record, it's great when the bass player, if you're playing, you know, a groove, and you do a cool fill. And bass player catches some of that, puts it down on the track, whatever it could be. Sounds great. Really good. Really good. All right, one more question.
What was your favorite song you played on your school desk when you got in trouble?
Oh, that was good. Aha. What I used to do is bang on the desk when I was in school. And the reason for that was I was like 16 years old, 16 and a half, and we were working with John Lennon that night. We did a number of things with Lennon because we rehearsed at the Record Plant Studios where he recorded. And we did Hand Claps on Whatever Gets You Through the Night, that song. And we did three videos with him. Then he produced The Singer. We were the band. And then we did his last live appearance on TV. And it was me and my band, which had Angelo on bass, Angelo Arcuri, who became the engineer for Dio, recorded all the great albums. And we used to go to school the next day, and I'd be sitting there going, man, this is like being in a black and white world when last night was in color, working with John Lennon. So I'd be sitting on the desk. I'd do it anyway. Right, Lala?
Yes, you do.
At a restaurant, I'll sit there and go. Mm-hmm. Depends what how the table sounds, you know? You got two. It's weird. It just comes out, you know? That's my sister, Terry, never. She always goes, does that just come out? I go, yeah. Just like you sit down, you don't go, oh, what am I going to play? I'll play a song. No, I play. That just comes out, you know, whatever it is. That's from years of playing, plus it's a groove, you know. It's steady. I hear what's going on. It's nice and steady. Or you do something like this. You play low, set up the groove, then you do a fill. Again. So anyway, I played on the desk. The teacher would be trying to teach. Eventually the teacher would go, wait a minute. Who's that drumming? Vincent, stop that drumming. And I'd stand up and I'd say, excuse me, Miss Teacher, did anyone else in this room, in this classroom, play with one of the Beatles last night? And then I got up and I excused myself. I don't recommend doing that to you young folks watching the show. You got to go to school. So, okay. So anyway, thank you guys for joining me. And next week I'll be gone. Because what's next week? The 20th. Everybody's going to be shopping and wrapping gifts and stuff. So, you know, all that stuff. Then the next week is the 27th. So let's take 2 weeks off. See, when you become a professional musician, you can take some time off here and there. And then I'll be back. When is the next one after that? What's that?
I don't know. I don't have mine.
Well, not the 27th. It would be fun, like the 3rd. Yeah, I'll come back in January. All right, thank you, and you guys have a merry, merry Christmas and a happy new year, happy holidays, Hanukkah, everything. And love you guys, and thanks for listening, and I'll see you soon. I'll see you in January, okay?